All right. Okay. So, welcome everyone. Thank you for coming. This is a joint seminar by the Department of Portuguese and Department of Communication. It gives me fantastic, enormous, and overwhelming pleasure to introduce Rod Watson, have him here. I'll give you a little bit of his introduction, but it no way captures much of what he's done, but just the highlights, I think. He is currently professor at Institut Marcel Mauss in Paris, as well as Paris Tech and Telecom. He previously was at Disbury College in Manchester, University of Lancaster, and then Reader in Manchester until 2008.
That's right.
Yeah.
2010.
He's held visiting professorships or research appointments in France, Brazil, Switzerland, US, Canada, Japan, Australia, to name a few, and a number of applied consultancies. My favourite is the consultant to the Lancashire Constabulary in Chorley.
Yes.
On hostage negotiation in terrorist and other situations.
That's right, yeah.
In 1985. I don't know if that ever came in useful, but I'd have never heard any terrorist attacks in Chorley, so.
Well,
it must have been useful.
The Lancashire Constabulary is a totally rural, rurally based constabulary, but there was a law in Britain passed that every constabulary had to be had to be trained in techniques of hostage negotiation.
So. Rod has also been won the Distinguished Publications Section Award for the American Sociological Association in 2009. Mm. And edited and authored over 100 publications. So, without further ado, I'm very, very happy to introduce Rod and to hear his reflections on ethnomethodology and Harvey Sachs is particularly dear to me at the moment, so I've just got a grant to look at Harvey Sachs, so I'm very happy with that. And thank you very much, Rod. Thank you.
Thank you too, Richard, for that. And I've got to now try and live up to your extremely flattering description, for which I'm most grateful. What I thought I would do today would be to talk a little bit about my life in ethnomethodology, miserable and small thing that it is, and I think that I'm not going to be telling you too much about my life, which has not been particularly interesting, but I have tried to use my own biography as a way of introducing ethnomethodology to people who may not be that familiar with it, and trying to tell you a little bit about the changes and developments in ethnomethodology over the decades, you know, to which I've been sort of witness and to some extent participant. And that's how I will do my biography, to tell you about ethnomethodology more than anything else. I have recently written a paper in the Handbook of Pragmatics. It's just come out, it's online, which gives a great deal more detail on the development of ethnomethodology than I can give you here. I'm wanting today to treat it with a fairly light touch, really. But if you are really serious, and you'll have to be serious because this article is 18,000 words long, if you're really serious about wanting to look at the development of ethnomethodology and the changes that have occurred within it, which are very significant, then that article may assist you. So that's in the Handbook of Pragmatics, which is published by the International Pragmatics Association and John Benjamin's publishers in the Netherlands. Okay then, well, let me start by just telling you a little bit about, you know, why I've kind of gravitated towards ethnomethodology. When I was a school kid, you know, 17 or something, I was very, very keen on a French short story writer called Guy de Maupassant. He was an interesting guy for a variety of reasons. One of the things was that although I'd, you know, read quite a lot of fiction, there wasn't that much fiction at all on everyday life. And Guy de Maupassant wrote about everyday life and about things that can happen, often very consequential ones in everyday life. And I thought that was kind of novel. But the thing that interested me particularly was a kind of the story that I had read in the literary criticism about Maupassant. he was taught how to write by the great novelist Gustave Flaubert in Rouen, in the north of France. And he had gone as a very young man to Flaubert and said, "Can you teach me to write?" And Flaubert said, "Okay, well, let's go down the park." So they went down the park, and Maupassant had his pen or pencil and notebook. And Flaubert said, "Leave that notebook alone for a while." And he made Maupassant describe the people who were passing in the park. And to produce, I guess, categorizations of them and all this kind of stuff. And Maupassant was not allowed to write up his observations until he'd actually done the observations. In other words, observe first and write afterwards. Write it up afterwards. I'm sure it's a kind of apocryphal story, but this is what I read. And when I got to the University of Leicester as an undergraduate to take sociology, it rather surprised me that, you know, you wrote first and observed second. In other words, you had to write a theory first, and then you went out and observed, and if your observations didn't fit the theory, then you adjusted your observations so that they did fit the theory. It's what's often called in philosophy a Procrustean bed. And that rather surprised me, you know, given the sort of Maupassant thing that I rather expected. The one thing about ethnomethodology is that you, in its best form, in its best practice, I would say, you observe first and you analyze second. You do your writing afterwards. It's an observation-based and an observation-driven kind of approach. But at Leicester University, which was a very good university for sociology, I was so fortunate to be there. The game, sociology was a theory game. We were taught how to analyze data, but if you decided to analyze data, it was made very clear that you were a craftsman or craftswoman, craftsperson. But if you were a theorist, you were an intellectual. So there was a status distinction between doing theory and doing empirical analysis, and the status advantage was clearly to that of theory. So I became a theorist, and I love social theory to this very day. But there wasn't much in the way of what we would call naturalistic observation and writing of any kind. There were some snippets, though. I was taught by a great classic sociologist whose name was Norbert Elias, or Elias if you're a European. And Elias was, you know, a man with Weberian kind of ambitions and understandings of the world. He wrote a huge book called The Civilizing Process, talking about the increases in normative control over the centuries, in the normative control of people's actions. And I was a student of Norbert Elias, and during my master's degree in Leicester, I walked into a seminar where Norbert was giving this seminar. He was teaching us our sociology. There were only about half a dozen people in the seminar. It was a great privilege to have a small seminar with such a luminary. And he came in and he started talking about the use of knives and forks at mealtime. And I thought, what the heck is this? But the more he talked about it, the more I began to realize that there's a genuine phenomenon here. That, you know, until the late Middle Ages, if you had a knife on the table, it was because you wanted to stab one of your fellow diners. Knives were weapons in those days. They weren't used for cutting up meat. or potatoes or whatever they were eating. Aristocrats too in those days would eat with their fingers and wipe their hands on dogs that were sitting under the table and things like this. So the knife and fork as sort of utensils with which you would eat and feed yourself, it was a relatively late development. And Elias analyzed the development of social conventions around the use of the knife and fork, social constraints and social controls. And he looked at that over the centuries. It was an astonishing thing. And so it sounded so funny to be talking about how people use knives and forks, but suddenly you realize that there is a sociological phenomenon there, which is entirely serious. And although people might make fun of it, it's because they don't know the sociology. The fun is ignorant fun, if you see what I mean. The other thing is, another of my teachers was Anthony Giddens, who told us about Goffman. I had a lecture or two on Goffman. But I don't think he really was too much into Goffman. He didn't tell us about Goffman's relation to Georg Simmel, for instance, in terms of formal sociology, where Goffman really was the new Simmel at the time. But he didn't make that connection. He didn't tell us about the Durkheim, Radcliffe Brown, Lloyd Warner link, or the Everett Hughes link with Goffman, or the Kenneth Burke link, because Kenneth Burke, of course, the literary analyst, is the man who developed dramatistic analysis. And that's where Goffman got his performance, his dramaturgical analogy from, the performance analogy from. He got it from Kenneth Burke. None of that. So we got Goffman in a rather denuded sense, but at least we got some kind of understanding that he was talking about the presentation of self and there were performative aspects of this. Giddens tended to present this as a kind of social psychology, which it kind of is, but kind of isn't as well. So there were little snippets that kind of encouraged me in my sort of observational interests, but not much. The rest was theory. And if your observations didn't fit the theory, you didn't adjust the theory to the observations. You were taught to adjust the observations to the theory so that they fitted the theory. In other words, that came to be known later on by people like Frederick Cruz as theoreticism, where the theorist basically creates a theory and pulls the ladder up behind him so that you can't really disconfirm the theory, you can't really modify it. The theory is tautological, it's self-justifying. And I think that it's self-authorizing, as it were. And I think that a lot of sociology, at least in Britain and in continental Europe, is still of that kind. It's theoreticism. A little bit like psychoanalysis, where they say, if you're resisting our analysis, you're in denial, or one or other of the ego defense mechanisms is in play, isn't it? You're projecting, you're displacing, you have a reaction formation. Anything to save the theory. Now, that is something that when I went to Didsbury College, I had the chance to attack and criticize. I got a job at Didsbury College, which was a constituent college of the University of Manchester, a teacher's college, really. And I was there because it was the University of Manchester. I met two young people at the Department of Sociology and Anthropology at the University of Manchester. One of these guys was called Wes Sharrock. He is still there. And the other is John Lee, who had the wisdom to buy a small house in the Dordogne and retire at a very early age. And he is a happy man, and we all resent him for this. Now, Wes and John had been there before. They were the true initiators of ethnomethodology in Britain. I'm often credited with that, but I came there a year later, so I'm not. I did not start it up. They did, and they did so because of Irving Goffman. Irving Goffman had come to Manchester University as a visiting Simon professor, because he was a great admirer of Max Gluckman, who was the professor there. And Gluckman was an interesting guy because he decided to create, following people like Firth, a culturally indigenous ethnography, or a culturally indigenous anthropology. In other words, he turned anthropology away from looking at traditional societies in Africa to looking at our own society, particularly Manchester. And Goffman liked that. Goffman was doing very much the same kind of thing. So he came to visit Max Gluckman and all this. And he told Wes and John, my friends by that time, that essentially their interests would be best represented by looking at the work of this man, Harold Garfinkel. Now, Wes and John hadn't heard of him. I had, and I frequently remind them of this, preferably in public, so this to their greater detriment. And I had read the Degradation Ceremonies paper. And Goffman said, read Garfinkel, and read the philosopher who informs Garfinkel's work, Alfred Schütz. And John and Wes were reading Garfinkel and Schütz when I arrived in Manchester, so I joined them in that task. And it was a revelation. And I should say that it was a very, very generous thing of Goffman to mention Garfinkel and Schütz to Wes and John. For two reasons. First of all, you know, Goffman had helped to get Garfinkel's book Studies in Ethnomethodology accepted by Prentice Hall. So it was through Goffman's good offices that that was published in the first place, because there were great problems in getting that book published. It was Goffman who pushed it through. Secondly, Goffman at that time was writing a critique of ethnomethodology and of Schütz's work. It was called Frame Analysis. It took a long time to write. One of the reasons it took a long time to write, I suspect, is that when Goffman was in Manchester, he spent a lot of time at the Salford Casino. So it might have come out. It might have come out earlier had he not been there. On the other hand, he was a consistent winner.
As I say, well, not at all if he'd won.
Yeah, well, yeah, absolutely. Well, indeed. But he did win. He came back with, you know, upwards of £200 every night. But he had been an observer of casinos in Las Vegas, and there is a famous lost manuscript which we don't have of his ethnographic observations. So Wes and John and I started reading this, and reading Garfinkel, we became aware of three or four different problems with conventional or orthodox sociology. The first is that of theoreticism that I've spoken with you a little bit about, that sociologists in Britain and in continental Europe tended to resolve empirical problems by means of applying a theory. So it was the theory that solved the empirical problems rather than anything like observation or data. That was a puzzling thing to us. Even though we all loved theory, one of the theories that was hated in the 1960s and 70s in Britain were the theories of Talcott Parsons. Because he's regarded as a consensus theorist and, practicing the dark arts of consensus theory. But John, Wes and I loved Parsons' work. We thought it was a masterpiece. But, of course, there was a problem. The problem was that he, too, thought that you could resolve empirical problems at the level of theory. You could depict society at the level of theory, And ultimately, the theory was all you needed. A bit of data would be helpful if it were corroborative data, but other than that, you didn't really need it too much. The other thing that we missed was language. I did my entire undergraduate and some of my postgraduate life in Leicester University under the impression that society was somehow created by people who could not communicate with each other, because we were never told anything about language. If they could do it without communicating, that would be quite an achievement. But even with communication, it was an achievement. And so that was a big problem for us, because with Garfinkel, who talked about the mastery of ordinary language being at the heart of social order, we didn't see any example of that in sociology, with one exception. And that exception was a guy called Basil Bernstein, who nobody knows about now, but Martin's written about. And Bernstein talked about language and social class and how that was all sort of mediated through education. And it was very interesting. I heard Bernstein speak several times, and he was really, it was a superb. He was so enthusiastic, and he was smart. He was really good. The only problem was that the theory didn't really work, and he had no empirical basis for it whatsoever. He tended to use invented examples, which somehow managed to fit the theory he was wanting to present. But with that reservation, I will say that we British sociology owes a lot to Bernstein, because he was and he and his group were out there on their own in insisting that language was an important aspect of social life. It seems so obvious, doesn't it, that language is a matter of social life, because it's everywhere. But that's exactly the trouble. Language is everywhere, so you don't really notice it specifically. And, you know, generations of sociologists had missed it specifically. We found that to be really rather strange. And the other thing, of course, back to Maupassant, really, was that you could read Parsons, wonderful on the normative components of the Unit Act and the normative aspects of the social system and all this. It was wonderful stuff. The only thing is, you couldn't get a picture of your society out of it at all. You know, you were surrounded by everyday life. You couldn't get a picture of everyday life out of Parsons' work. And, you know, Maupassant was better than that, and he wasn't a sociologist. So that was a problem for us as well. We were in a society which we could see all around us, and Parsons didn't help us to really understand that society or picture it or describe it. There we are then. So that was that. Those were the problems we found with conventional sociologies. The problem was brought back to me, incidentally, one day when we had a visiting American professor in the sociology department at Didsbury. His name was Kenneth J. Downey, and he was a statistician. He wasn't an ethnomethodologist. And he came one day to the department, and we took him out to lunch. He'd just arrived. We took him out to lunch. And there was one key for the Department of Sociology. It was in a special house called Swan Lake. So we all went out to lunch. We came back, and our head of department, who will remain anonymous, it was Ted Kerf. I'd lost the key. And Ken said, "That's all right." And he took a penknife out from his pocket and picked the lock, and we got in. And I said, "Good Lord, how did you do that?" He said, "Well," he said, "I love the Chicago ethnographies, and in one of his studies of professional thieves, Edwin H. Sutherland tells you how to pick a lock." And he did it from the book. Now, you could have read Parsons for a long, long time, and he would never have been able to tell you how to pick a lock. That was wonderful stuff. So, you know, basically, we found those gaps, and we decided to try and create a version of Garfinkel's sociology that did fill those gaps. And we decided that Schutzer's work was not really very relevant for this. It was wonderful to read, and he did talk about everyday life and the attitude of everyday life, and he talked about everyday life as people in the social world, ordinary people, actually experience it, which was the big breakthrough for ethnomethodology. But even in Schutz, language is a bit of an afterthought. He talks about typifications, and like in about the third volume, he says, oh yes, and by the way, language is the typifying medium. Well, too late. We need to start with language, not finish with it, in my opinion. So, and also we found that there was quite a bit of a cognitivistic residue in Schutzer's work. It's what we call a psychological reductionism then, but we later rejigged that to make it sound more fancy. It was a cognitivistic residue, especially when he was talking about choosing between projects of action and all the rest of it. It was a bit too much like a cognitivistic decision theory for us. So we decided to change the basis of ethnomethodology from phenomenology, which is Schutzer's position. He was an interpreter of Husserl's phenomenology, to the philosophy of Wittgenstein, especially the later philosophy, the philosophical investigations, and people who were working along the same lines in what might be called linguistic philosophy. Peter Winch, Alfred R. Lauch, J.L. Austin, Gilbert Ryle, a lot of them. Those were the people that we liked. And these were the people who really tried to abolish psychologism in the analysis of language in social interaction. They tried to abolish psychological residues in the analysis of how language worked as a social practice. So that really appealed to us. We thought it worked better. For instance, Schutz talks about indexicality, the issue of contextuality of utterances. He talks about indexicality in terms of kernel and halo meanings. Well, this is lovely stuff. It's nice warm glow stuff, but it doesn't really work. Wittgenstein, in philosophical investigations and similar studies, talked about family resemblances, which nails indexicality once and for all, in my opinion. So that was the first thing. If you go to Britain, British ethnomethodology looks very different from American ethnomethodology, because we established a Wittgensteinian basis for it, really, because we thought, as I say, that would place language use and language as a social practice onto center stage. So that's what we did, and it kind of worked very, very well for us. I think because we were in Britain, we were used to this kind of philosophy. And John Lee had been trained in this kind of philosophy with Alan White at the University of Hull, so he knew what he was doing. And I think the Wittgensteinian stuff stayed in British ethnomethodology, as you know, Richard, very well. And in Manchester, we developed something called the Manchester Ethnography Group, which was a way of looking at ethnographies which were done with a kind of Wittgensteinian analytic mentality. There was another gap that troubled us very much in Manchester about conventional sociology. And that was that many, many sociologists, the vast majority of them, treated members of society as Durkheim did. He treated them as a kind of individual, as a sort of tabula rasa, as people who are basically do not have knowledge, cannot reason. They are just in the society, pushed and pulled about by normative forces and existential forces of various kinds. The overall kind of structure of the society is what pushed these people around willy-nilly. They had no actual practical effect on their circumstances. They had no knowledge, they had no reasoning capacity. They were what Garfinkel called cultural dopes. And Garfinkel very nicely called this with hyphens, a hyphenated phrase. You are machine gunned with hyphenation in Garfinkel's work. And this is one of them. It is the man in the sociologist's society. This was before gender neutral terminology and all the rest of it. But it was all hyphenated, the man in the sociologist's society. And you can almost hear the content dripping out of that phrase, because Garfinkel, of course, wanted to see society members as practical sociologists, essentially, as practical reasoners about their world. And he talked about them in terms of their practical sociological reasoning. And that too appealed to us very much, because, you know, we could see people using this reasoning in every respect. When they're crossing the road, when they're queuing up, you know, when they're speaking to each other in turns, this is all to do with practical reasoning, not of the psychological kind, but of the but culturally based reasoning. Let's leave it at that for the moment. So this appealed to us as well. And of course, it fit in very well with what Wittgenstein was saying about what we would call society membership. So we developed that kind of line for a long time. And thanks to Irving Goffman, even though he really began to hate ethnomethodology at that time, was trying to write a critique of it, still directed Wes and John towards ethnomethodology, which, you know, was which showed that he was a real mensch. And utterly convinced us that that was the way to go. Then we, of course, also did a lot of work in the Chicago sociologies, the work of Howard Becker, Irving Goffman, of course, and others. Anselm Strauss, who came to Manchester, a lot of the symbolic interactionists did. Plus people who don't describe themselves as symbolic interactionists, like Howard Becker. So they too talked a lot about everyday life, and we learned a lot from them. And in fact, probably Garfinkel owes the fact that he never got a broken jaw to one of these people. Howard Becker told me that during a very big debate between conventional sociologists and ethnomethodologists, called the Purdue debate on ethnomethodology, which produced a symposium called the Purdue Symposium, one of the participants, a statistician, became so angry at Harold Garfinkel's formulation of sociology that he actually reached across the table to grab Garfinkel and punch him. And the symbolic interactionist got in between them and stopped them from fighting. So, you know, that's what I call commitment. Okay, so anyway, we then went to the University of Edinburgh, because Edinburgh had started a conference organized by R.J. Wilson, again, which was to have the British Purdue Symposium, and it nearly again ended up in a fight. Harvey Sachs and Harold Garfinkel were invited. Garfinkel didn't turn up, but Sachs and David Sudnow, a famous, wonderful ethnomethodologist, did turn up eventually. But the conference started without them. Their plane was delayed. And two people, an anthropologist, Ernest Gellner, and a sociologist, Percy Cohen, who'd been one of my teachers and a person I really revered, a very brilliant sociologist, as you know, Richard, came up and they got up onto the podium and did a sort of ad hoc critique of ethnomethodology, which neither of these critiques really worked. because they mischaracterized ethnomethodology in the first place. And the real test of any critic of any perspective in sociology or linguistics or anything else is, before they begin their criticisms, do they produce a good description of that which they intend to criticize? If they don't do that, then, you know, the rest will never work. Gellner did that. And Gellner got up and was extremely insulting about Harvey Sachs, my gosh, and about ethnomethodologists generally. We were all presented as being hippies. And even though I was there in a Harris tweed jacket and tie, you know, I'm not exactly a hippie, but we were all cast as hippies. And basically, one of the reasons why we were doing ethnomethodology is that we were all doing drugs, and this was clearly a drug-induced fantasy. Unbelievable stuff. And he got stuck into Harvey Sachs, attacking Sachs, because, you know, Sachs's plane was late, so he felt free. And we were all standing around, and there was a guy there in purple jeans and a kind of a dark sort of plum red shirt, and another guy in denims as well next to him. And suddenly this guy got onto the podium after Gellner had staggered off. Gellner had imbibed quite a lot. And he comes up, and we thought, oh, it's a student. It's just a student getting up to address us, you know. And how dare they? It's a student. And he says, Harvey Sachs, professor of sociology at the University of California at Irvine. This was Harvey. He'd arrived on time after all and had heard all of this. And he produced the most coruscating refutation of Gellner's arguments that you can imagine. This was my introduction to Harvey Sachs and later to David Studnow. And you could see Gellner and Cohen curling up in their seats with embarrassment. It was a wonderful sight. So that's basically the first time. And that ended up again in a big kind of argument. And it really meant that conferences weren't the way to proceed this kind of stuff. Writing was. The trouble is, we were all writing papers in ethnomethodology, and nobody would publish them, because ethnomethodology was treated as like the spawn of the devil. It was really treated as though it were an utterly stigmatizing thing. And so nobody would publish our work. So we started circulating it between ourselves. At least we could read each other's work. And that was about the only option we had. Richard was telling me that in Harvey Sachs's correspondence that he has read in the archives, that Harvey's stuff was rejected too by the British Journal of Sociology.
Swiftly. You know, swiftly rejected.
Swiftly rejected, yes, absolutely. So anyway, of course that fed into the notion of ethnomethodology of a kind of cult. They don't publish their work. They just circulated amongst themselves. But of course, we were dying to be published. We were young. I was in my 20s. I was dying to be. Nobody would publish my stuff. So that was a big problem. And it took me a long time to get over that. At the same time, I was writing my PhD at the University of Leeds. My supervisor was a guy called Robert Towler, who was a phenomenologist. He knew no ethnomethodology. So he said, well, you know, Rod, I don't really know much ethnomethodology, but I do know somebody who's getting into it. So he says, he phones up this person, and this person comes into the box, and he said, oh, hi, I'm John Heritage. And that was the beginning of a long friendship, and basically my PhD was a conversation with John Heritage. Garfinkel came. And I'll go on for just 10 minutes if I may.
Please.
Garfinkel came in 1973. And by that time, he had rejigged, he'd reconceptualized ethnomethodology. Ethnomethodology changed all the time. It was never the same. The reason why people think it was the same is to really due to the tyranny of studies in ethnomethodology. That book stood on behalf of the entire swathe of ethnomethodology over the decades. And Garfinkel came, everything he said had nothing to do with studies in ethnomethodology. In ethnomethodology, we were reading about a collection of sense-making practices called the documentary method of interpretation. By the time Garfinkel came to Manchester, the documentary method of interpretation, which was talked about, it was like the working of a hermeneutic circle. It was the reciprocal reflexive relation between a set of appearances and an underlying pattern. So, for instance, in Garfinkel's study of the Los Angeles Suicide Prevention Center, you know, it was a cheerful thing looking at ethnomethodology. You got to see suicide and stuff like this. He looked at how the coroner examined a corpse on a marble slab, a particular cut of the throat, if the throat had been cut, and other kinds of evidences. These were indexical particulars, which pointed to an underlying pattern, the underlying pattern being suicide, usually. So the documentary method looked at how these particulars pointed to an underlying pattern, and once imputed, the underlying pattern reinforced these appearances and reinforced the relationship between them. And Garfinkel's documentary method was a classic ethnomethodological formulation, but he rejected it by the time we got to 1973 and Garfinkel came. Instead, he was talking about other things. He was talking about themes that were there already in ethnomethodology, but he was beginning to conceptualize them in a different way and therefore highlight these themes. One of these themes was, of course, the notion of Gestalt Contextur. He talked about a Gestalt Contextur, and he replaced the documentary method with the notion of the Gestalt Contextur, which is essentially a phenomenal system of interdependent functional significances. It's really from a guy called Aaron Gurwitch, a kind of phenomenologist. And that replaced the documentary method. My paper in the Handbook of Pragmatics, the annual review, goes into a great deal more detail about that if you're at all interested. Garfinkel started looking at specific distributions of knowledge. So, for instance, the doctor's work or whatever it happened to be at the time, the mathematician's work, and insisted that if the ethnomethodologist were to study a medical doctor's work or a mathematician's work, he or she had to know the medicine, had to be into the medicine, had to be able to operate the medicine. So that recently, for instance, there's a magnificent book called Respecifying Lab Ethnography by a guy called Philippe Sormani. It was published about 18 months ago, I guess, where Sormani was looking at subatomic particles, you know, with a physicist, looking at the work of the physicist. And Sormani had to learn the procedures of observing and analysing subatomic particles. It's just an amazing thing, samples of these particles and stuff like this. And he learned that competence in order to do an ethnomethodological analysis of the working of science. That came from Garfinkel 1973, where he said you've got to have the competence. He called it the unique adequacy requirement. If you didn't have the competence that people with special distributions of knowledge like doctors or whoever it is had, then you really were only a novice. You could never be an ethnographer per se. He talked also about what he first called quiddity and then called heseity. He talked about social settings and talked about their distinctive identifiability as just this social setting rather than any other. And he gives a little parable here about that, and I'll be I'm getting very close now to closing. He, early in his career, he was a hired hand sociologist. He couldn't get a job, so he was working on a whole variety of different research projects. And in Chicago, he came upon a project and was hired for a project where Fred Strodbeck, a sociologist of law, had tape recorded the deliberations of a jury in traffic court trials. So we had these tape recordings of a jury. The office of the President of the United States had to give permission for this to be done, and they got it. So we got these tapes, said Harold. And Strodbeck said, well, what we need to do is to treat this jury as a small group and look at the jury as a group and look at small group processes that will apply to any small groups anywhere, whether they're families, work groups, juries, or whatever, sports teams, the issue of norm formation, status hierarchies, the emergence of leadership structures, etc., etc. All that stuff that you get in the very formal small group sociology. And so the question was, how can we treat the jury as a small group? However, one of Garfinkel's colleagues, Ed Shills, said, well, why don't we try and figure out instead what makes this small group a jury? Surely that's more to the point. Strodbeck argued Shills out of that position, but Garfinkel remained convinced that that was the way to go. In other words, what is it that makes this small group a jury? How can we see it, and how can, above all, the participants themselves see this as a jury that is doing the work of a jury, a distinctively identifiable thing? And that, of course, gave us something that gave us the later form of ethnomethodology. Garfinkel says that when you're looking at what a jury does that defines it as a jury, you're looking at what he called the distinctive phenomenal field details of that jury's work, i.e. particularly what they were doing as juries, making legal decisions, making those legal decisions in terms of their common sense knowledge, but certainly taking into account the legal rules. That's what made them a jury. Garfinkel said that that was what we should be looking at. The concrete, specific, phenomenal detail of every social setting, the thing that made it distinctive for both the participants and the analysts. Whereas he said, basically, in sociology as a whole, we tend to look at social order in the abstract, not in the concrete. We look at things like the abstract properties of small groups. So looking in the abstraction was something that Garfinkel wanted to get sociologists away from. He wanted, especially ethnomethodologists, of course, to look at the concrete phenomenal detail of this. And that he called it the quiddity originally, and later turned that term towards aseity, because somebody else, a philosopher, had used quiddities for a different reason. And that brings us to the extremely difficult issue, I think, of the kind of language that Garfinkel uses in studies in ethnomethodology and later on too. As you've tried to read it, many of you, you'll have found that it's extremely difficult. Extremely difficult. It's extremely difficult even for a native English speaker. Heaven help the foreign language speaker reading this stuff. As I say, you get machine gunned by hyphenation. And very different terms. If you've been trained in phenomenology, it's much, much easier. But the trouble is that sociology largely is not a phenomenological approach, it's a neo-Kantian approach. So you get trained out of this kind of vocabulary. It's what Thorstein Veblen called trained incapacity, and there sure is plenty of that in sociology. So, you know, essentially, you really have to work very hard, and you've got to keep rereading Garfinkel. The irony of it is that although it looks obscure, Garfinkel is a wonderful writer. His first ever publication was a short story called Color Trouble, which won the best short story of the United States. It won a prize, the best short story of the United States for that year. You begin to look at the paragraphs in Garfinkel's work. You know, most people would need an article, perhaps a book, to explicate what's in that paragraph. It's wonderfully compressed, like a short story. I suppose all I can say here is that you can't have an intellectual revolution in a discipline whilst adhering to the vocabulary of the ancien regime, the thing you're revolting against. You have to have a new vocabulary. And that's what Garfinkel did. Since then, there have been many clear expositions of ethnomethodology, not least by John Heritage himself. And I think that that was very, very important to clarify it. But it was only because Garfinkel cleared the ground for that kind of exercise that people could write more clearly about it. And we've now got conversation analysis, which has basically swept the world. It's just unbelievable, really. It's like Coca-Cola. And that, I think, is now becoming increasingly detached from ethnomethodology. I find that extremely sad, and my current work, and I'll continue to try to do this, is to try to continue to integrate ethnomethodology and conversation analysis, and also membership categorization analysis, the three main kind of branches of ethnomethodology, which I call the ethnomethodologies in the plural. And my reason for that is that conversation analysis looks at sequencing, it looks at recipient design, particularization procedures, it looks at all kinds of things like institutional talk, but all these things are what ethnomethodologists call ethnomethods, and therefore to me are subject to ethnomethodological analysis, and that is why ethnomethodology and conversation analysis should go together rather than being divided up. So I see these schisms in ethnomethodology and conversation analysis and membership categorization analysis as very sad and as something that I personally would want to seek to overcome. Okay, I should stop now. I've gone on far too long, but that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Rob. We have we'll have a few minutes for questions, I think. We're running a little bit late, but that's...
Yeah, when do I have to leave?
Sometime Tuesday, I think.
Tuesday, okay.
No, we have the beta session at 4 o'clock.
But of course, to yes. Okay, sure.
But I'll open the floor to any questions. I have a thousand that I could start with. And perhaps I could take the floor first of all. You mentioned Garfinkel a lot and the beginning of that within Manchester and how that influenced and influences the field. And how to read, and I guess what I was sort of quite noticed was you didn't really talk about Sachs here. Now, the ethnomethodological work in Manchester, for many they were following more of a Garfinkel Sachs line as opposed to a Sachs line. Now your work on Harvey Sachs, and I mean I was very much influenced by your and still am influenced by your work, but that kind of like looking at Sachs as Sachs for Sachs, how do you think that kind of like travels through? Manchester.
That travels through Manchester in a very specific way, which I think would interest you, Richard, very much, because Sachs is known now as the sort of progenitor of conversation analysis and of sequencing, and so he was. But when Sachs came to Manchester, he told us a story. He told us a story. He gave us some data on a woman who was talking about having given her coat a coat to a child who did not have one, a poor kid, and she said the coat didn't really fit this child, but the child ran up backwards and forwards delighted. And Sachs began by analysing this as a story in sequential terms and all the rest of it. We all know what he wrote about in terms of story format. But then he switched into ethnographic mode and said, this tells us a little bit about charity. We tend to see charity as something flowing from the donor, the giver, to the recipient. In this case, the small child. But really, charity is an exchange relationship. The child gets the coat. The woman who gave that child the coat gets the privilege of telling this story to her credit. And every time I see these great film stars, you know, sort of grandstanding their charitable work and all the rest of it, I think of Harvey's observation. And that's what affected us very strongly in Manchester, the ethnographic Sacks. The part of Sacks that I think the American conversation analysts edited out, but in Manchester, the ethnographic Sacks was massively influential. Partly because, you know, Wes and John were in a sociology and anthropology department with anthropologists like Max Gluckman, so they had an ethnographic sensibility. So that, I think, is what gave Sacks a special meaning for us in Manchester.
Mm, thank you. Anybody with...
How much do you say that scholars in North America and use mixed methods, including, for example, not only ethnomethodology or what we can say interpretive sociology, but also positivist, critical, you know, do you do that kind of mixed methods?
Well, when I went to, I did a lot of work in France, you know, following Maupassant's footsteps. And I began to work with people who were interested in ethnomethodology in France. And to my great dismay, they were doing just what you said. They were trying to integrate ethnomethodology with all kinds of things. Habermas, the theories of de Certeau, Dan Sperber, a lot of others. And the first generation of ethnomethodologists in France weren't really ethnomethodologists at all, they were synthesizers. It seems to me that they had ignored one major argument that Garfinkel had, that if you wanted to look at order in the abstract, you needed one set of concepts. If you wanted to look at order in the concrete phenomenal detail, you needed a completely different set of concepts. The trouble is, when you use the second set of concepts, the first ones disappeared, order in the abstract disappeared. If you use the order in the abstract ones, then the specifying concept disappeared. So if you're doing ethnomethodology, conventional sociology disappears, and vice versa if you're doing conventional sociology. In other words, Garfinkel is saying that ethnomethodology defies such integration. And here were these basically French ethnomethodologists doing just that, trying to integrate. They were committing what I think people like Gilbert Ryle call a category mistake. They were in effect trying to put together two jigsaw puzzles to create one big picture. And instead, what you get, of course, when you put two jigsaw puzzles together is incoherence. And I think that is really the kind of line that that ethnomethodologists have always taken, that eventually in France we got, you know, ethnomethodologists who did not integrate, but it took a whole generation for that to happen. So what Garfinkel says is that ethnomethodology is an asymmetrical, incommensurate alternate to conventional sociologies. So, you know, that in that respect there is, in a sense, no middle ground.
At the back.
Perhaps interfering a little bit with the question of us, you know how, and also perhaps to challenge a bit Garfinkel. I would say the case that we were talking yesterday, the deliberation process of judges, panel of judges in appeal courts, maybe in a certain way they could be compared also with the procedures that, you know, the members of a jury, they undertake.
Yes.
You know, in terms of forming alliances and forming the legal and so on. But the thing is, when you have the reality of Brazil, in which this deliberation process of judges is not only constricted to a room, no closed doors, but it's public, and you have the deliberation process being broadcasted lively,
sure,
or live, not only on TV, but YouTube, radio, and everything. So those dynamics that maybe Garfinkel says, this is too abstract, this is too broad, this is macro sociology, I want to know the micro dynamics.
Mm.
And maybe these things, for example, what Marx says, class ideology and so on, maybe... So it's not the dynamics within the group itself, but you have some external elements, you know, that refer to these broad elements that the classical sociologists they have worked with, interfering their behavior. Then maybe Garfinkel is wrong, not to mix the methods.
Well, should I repeat that for the...
yes, please.
If you'll forgive me, I have to repeat this because it's not picking up what Dennis said. Dennis is saying that under certain circumstances, things that happen in certain settings are, are influenced by elements beyond the settings in various ways. He gives the example of judges in Brazil who actually perform in public, making their adjudications. And of course, that is an issue. Well, I think, incidentally, ethnomethodology doesn't use the term micro and macro. That's the kind of vocabulary of these reifying sociologies that ethnomethodology is trying to get away from. Ethnomethodology is really a praxeological sociology. It's a sociology of social practice rather than one that relies on reified views, you know, derived from Durkheim and so on, of what society is like. That's where these micro and macro conceptions come from. You know, they don't really work to characterize ethnomethodology. You know, I basically think that they are terms that with Durkheim, you know, to me, Durkheim was a metaphysician posing as a scientist. What we get in Durkheim is scientism, not science. Now, in terms of your example, Dennis, let me take that. One of the things that the judges will be doing then, they will be making their adjudications. There's an audience there, maybe an audience on TV, maybe an audience in the room. One of the things that they will be doing in discussing their adjudications is designing that discussion for what we might call an overhearing audience. The audience may be present, it may be only electronically present, but we will be able to see the influence of what you call an external source actually in those deliberations. And the same thing goes for decisions that are made and that are perhaps written down in front of the judge. That are made in different rooms. The decision has to be taken into account by the judge. There is a text there. The judge will be reading that decision in the text. So really what we might say there is that what would influence Garfinkel if he's looking at judges' determinations, judges' negotiations, because there's more than one judge in this situation, what Garfinkel will be looking at is how those so-called external sources are actually internalized within the setting of the adjudication. And when you begin to look at it this way, you know, you can treat the judge's decisions as being rather self-contained and yet still incorporating these so-called external sources. And then, of course, it makes the whole notion of internal and external rather problematic.
Okay, thank you. Just one final question, and I will... can I take it, Terry? And you can ask later.
He's the cameraman, so he's...
While you're here, I'd like sort of just to reflect just a little bit on what you think or you see are the challenges for ethnomethodology, conversation analysis, membership category analysis going into the future?
Yes, I think the main, before getting to Terry, I think the main challenge is essentially to stop. Basically, I think, you know, they've got this old saying, if you're digging a hole and burying yourself, stop digging. I wish the ethnomethodologist would do that sometimes, because there is now a massive schism between ethnomethodology and conversation analysis. It's to do with how you analyze differential distributions of knowledge in society and all that. And there is also the issue of membership categorization analysis, which is often seen as a kind of pariah approach with relation to both of those things, you know. I mean, the only thing about ethnomethodology and conversation analysis is that at least they can get together to hate membership categorization analysis. So we serve a very important function, really, Richard. I hate to see these strands of what I regard as essentially the same stream of thinking and analysis being divided up in this kind of way. I think it is a self-destructive thing. And the greatest challenge is, in my opinion, to keep them together. And I think it's entirely possible to find halfway houses and all this kind of stuff, and to be inclusive rather than exclusive. That's the major thing.
But yeah. Just say thank you very much, Rod, for enlightening and very entertaining conversation and paper. Thanks for the audience for coming and participating.
Absolutely, yes.
And
thank you for coming,
everybody. Thank you, University of Macau. Thank you.
Indeed, yeah. Thank you. Thank you.